After studying this module, you will be able to know about the high-powered money edge in detail, learn about the components of and factors affecting edge, identify the impact of changes in cash reserve ratio on high-powered money, evaluate the relative importance of the factors affecting edge, and analyze the impact of adjusted edge on the money supply in the economy.
We are already aware of two principal determinants of money supply, high-powered money and money multiplier. The money multiplier framework postulates a relationship between ordinary money supply M and high-powered money H. Here, M is the ordinary money supply produced by Reserve Bank of India and the government and is held by the public in the form of currency notes and coins CC as well as demand deposits DD. While high powered money is H, which is money produced by RBI and the government and is held by the public in the form of currency notes and by the banks in the form of reserves. It is sometimes called the monetary base. It includes all cash, even vault cash at commercial banks, which are redeemable in cash. These assets are called reserves because commercial banks hold them to honor checking account withdrawals during times when withdrawals exceed new deposits. New loans are also made out of reserves in the sense that a bank with no reserves would have no funds to loan out. High-powered money is important because it represents net wealth to the private sector. In contrast, checking account money called demand deposits represent an asset to the owner of the checking account but represent a liability from the perspective of the bank, which owes that money to a customer on demand, and therefore they are known as demand deposits. The liability cancels out with the asset, leaving a net effect of zero on the net wealth of the private sector. Commercial bank deposits at the central bank represent a liability to the central bank. The concept of high-powered money is important because the central bank directly controls the high-powered money and exerts only indirect control over measures of money supply, which are influenced by willingness of commercial banks to make loans and reserves.
H represents the monetary liabilities of RBI and the Government of India and is the money produced by the RBI and the government and held by the public and banks. The supply of high power, therefore, can be represented as the government currency, GC, and Reserve Bank money, RBM. They are held by the public and banks. Government currency consists of 1 rupee notes and coins and smaller denomination coins. Reserve Bank money comprises of all currency notes other than 1 rupee notes, deposits of banks with the RBI, and other deposits of banks with the RBI. The structural composition of H reveals that the proportion of government currency in the hands of the public and banks is a small proportion of the total stock of H outstanding. Hence, most of the observed changes in H are due to changes in RBM, which is also the monetary liability of the RBI.
The complex of forces affecting high-powered money H are the result of transactions of the RBI with the various sectors of the economy and the world at large in performance of its duties or its functions as the central bank. Thus, the central bank acts as a banker to the government, as a lender of last resort, or as a banker to other commercial banks and cooperative banks, and as the ultimate custodian of the country's foreign exchange reserves. In addition, it also makes funds available to the commercial sector via the various development banks.
The framework by which we study the operations of the various factors responsible for changes in RBM requires first an analysis of the balance sheet of the RBI. Monetary liabilities plus non-monetary liabilities is equal to financial asset plus other assets. If net non-monetary liabilities is equal to non-monetary liabilities minus other assets, then Reserve Bank money is equal to monetary liabilities is equal to fixed assets minus net non-monetary liabilities. The monetary liabilities are the RBM, and the factors affecting them could be identified as factors affecting financial assets and the net non-monetary liabilities. Financial assets are what the central bank acquires as a part of its central banking functions with other sectors like the government, banks, development banks, and the foreign sector. The RBI provides them its credit, acquires financial assets, and creates RBM in the process. We can deduce the Reserve Bank money to be equal to net RBC to the government plus RBC to banks plus RBC to development banks plus net foreign exchange assets of the RBI minus net non-monetary liabilities of the RBI. These will now be discussed individually. The RBI is a banker to both the central and state government. It invests in the treasury bills and other securities of the central government and gives advances to the state government. The gross Reserve Bank credit to the government is in the form of 1. Ad hoc and regular treasury bills and other securities of any maturity held by the RBI in its issue department. 2. Treasury bills purchased and discounted. 3. Investment in dated government securities. 4. Rupee coins in the issue and banking department of the RBI. And 5. Loans and advances given to the state government.
Till 1997, the central government could borrow any amount from the Reserve Bank of India. The state governments had a limit on their borrowing, but often ended up with unauthorized overdrafts. These were cleared by the state governments asking for increased plan assistance at the time of the budget from the central government. The central government would use their unlimited powers to borrow from the Reserve Bank of India to ultimately clear the overdrafts. However, the situation has changed post a historic agreement reached between Reserve Bank of India and Government of India in 1997.
The Reserve Bank of India gives credit to scheduled commercial banks in two forms. either as loans and advances against government securities, usance bills, or promissory notes as collateral, or through the purchase or rediscounting of internal commercial bills as well as treasury bills. The rate at which loans and advances are given is called the bank rate, and the rate at which the discounting is done is called the discount rate. The scheduled commercial banks keep their required reserves as balances with the RBI and are hence entitled to a certain amount of credit from the RBI, which the RBI cannot refuse. This is called the non-discretionary component of the RBI credit to banks. If the banks desire credit more than this amount, the RBI can refuse the credit. Hence, this is known as the discretionary component of the RBI credit to banks. Reserve bank credit to development banks or commercial sector. The development banks have been set up by the RBI to provide medium and long-term credit to agriculture and industry. They provide credit to the commercial sector. The development banks are the immediate recipients of credit from the RBI, while the commercial sector is the final recipient of credit. The RBI gives credit to development banks by either 1. Giving them loans and advances against government securities as collateral, or 2. By investing in the shares, debentures, bonds issued by the non-bank financial institutions like the IDBI, NABARD, or 3. By purchasing and rediscounting the internal commercial bills of exchange under bill rediscounting scheme. Like the scheduled commercial banks, there is an amount credit which development banks are entitled from the RBI. This is the non-discretionary quota of Reserve Bank credit to development banks, which the RBI cannot refuse. Any demand for credit over and above this amount can be refused by the RBI and is hence called the discretionary quota of credit from the RBI to development banks. This also leads to the generation of H, net foreign exchange assets of the RBI. The gross foreign exchange assets of the RBI consists of 1. Gold coin and bullion, 2. Foreign securities, including those held in the investment account by the RBI, and 3. Balances held abroad. From the gross foreign exchange assets, we subtract the foreign exchange liabilities consisting of India's contribution to IMF account number 1 quota subscription to get the net foreign exchange assets of the RBI. Any surplus or deficit in the balance of payments with the RBI gets reflected in the foreign exchange assets with the RBI.
Net monetary liabilities of Reserve Bank of India. The net RBC to various sectors discussed are financed by RBI partly by creating its monetary liabilities RBM and partly by its net non-monetary liabilities NNML. The larger these non-monetary resources of RBI, the less it has to depend on the creation of new H, that is high-powered money, to finance its credit to various sectors. Hence, this factor enters the equation of factors affecting RBM with a negative sign. The net non-monetary liabilities of the Reserve Bank in this equation on the left-hand side would be equal to non-monetary liabilities of the Reserve Bank minus other assets of the Reserve Bank. This is how we do the netting. The other assets of the RBI consist of premises, furniture, advances to certain scheduled commercial banks with respect to their investments abroad. The non-monetary liabilities consist of two heads. One is paid up capital of rupees 5 crores and reserves of rupees 150 crores. Thirdly, the contribution to the three national funds maintained by RBI.
Is H an autonomous policy determined variable or an endogenous variable? H is not a fully policy determined variable because it is the result of a decision of the monetary authorities, the public, as well as the banks, which leads to the generation or destruction of H. Banks and development banks can change H by varying their borrowing from the RBI, net purchase or sale of foreign exchange by the public also changes H. Despite this, because of the vast powers of monetary control by the RBI and the government, variations in the stock of H star or adjusted H are directly within the close control of the authorities, so that H star can be called a policy controlled variable. From the policy point of view, all changes in H can be classified into two categories. One, autonomous or discretionary changes in H, that is H1, and two, endogenous or non-discretionary changes in H, that is H2. And hence, all changes in H is equal to change in H1 plus changes in H2. Autonomous changes in H are determined directly by the policy-making authorities, the government and the RBI. They are A, changes in RBH due to government gross of the third item and including changes arising from OMO of the RBI. B, changes in the discretionary component of the RBH due to banks and development banks. C, net purchase or sale of foreign exchange and gold by the government from the public. The non-discretionary component or the endogenous part of the changes in H or H2 are decided by the public, banks, and development banks, given the terms and conditions under which the RBI is willing to produce such changes. They arise as a result of certain central banking functions of the RBI towards the public and banks, like being a banker's bank and the controller of all foreign exchange reserves of the country. Changes consist of A, changes in the government currency held by the public, B, changes in the non-discretionary component of the RBM due to banks and development banks, and C, net purchase or sale of foreign exchange by the public. The changes in the statutorily required cash reserve ratio or CRR affect the amount of disposable H available to the banks and the public because these changes either impound or release reserves of banks. When the CRR is revised upward, some reserves are impounded by the RBI, and when the CRR is revised downwards, some reserves get released. Impounding of reserves reduces and releasing of reserves increases the amount of disposable H. This disposable H is called adjusted H.
The cash reserve ratio is also one of the proximate determinants of money multiplier. The higher the reserve ratio and the less are the funds that the banks have to loan out. This leads to a lower creation of money and perhaps ultimately to a higher purchasing power of the money previously in use. Speaking formally, when the ratio is revised upwards, the expression of narrow and broad multiplier M1 and M3 decrease, leading to a lower multiple expansion of bank deposits on account of enhanced reserve ratio. However, to discuss the impact of H, which is the high-powered money on money supply, we should make the money multiplier invariant to changes in CRR and to adjust H to incorporate the effect of the reserve ratio changes. This makes the money multiplier an independently determined variable as far as the monetary authorities are concerned. The CRR is a monetary tool which is often levied as an average percentage of the demand for time and demand liabilities of a bank over a fortnight, as well as an incremental CRR which is levied on the increment to the demand and time liabilities after a base date. When the average or of the incremental CRR is raised or lowered, bank reserves are absorbed or released as a part of H, which is the high powered money. It is not available for deposit creation compared to the base period, and hence H has to be adjusted. The adjusted H increases or decreases as less or more reserves are available for deposit creation.
The adjustment factor is RT minus R0 into D plus IR minus DF, where RT is equal to current cash reserve ratio CRR, R0 is equal to initial or benchmark CRR, D is equal to demand and time liabilities relevant for the computation of CRR, DF is equal to net CRR default for all commercial banks, and IR is equal to incremental reserves. The adjustment factor is a measure of the bank reserves liberated or absorbed by the change in the reserve requirements compared with the base period and the adjusted reserve money. H star is equal to H minus adjustment factor. If the CRR increases, this implies that the adjustment factor increases, and this implies that a part of H is removed from deposit creation.
There are two additional assumptions we need to relax. One, banks hold excess reserves over and above the amount required as a part of CRR requirements of the RBI. When the banks hold desired excess reserves and do not lend them, then they create no deposits and hence no increase in the money supply takes place. That is, the desired excess reserve in the banking system are idle component of the reserves are, and that are not being used to support any deposits, and therefore such reserves should be subtracted from the reserve money and focus should be on the amount actually supporting the money supply. Secondly, banks can borrow from the Reserve Bank of India in the form of discretionary finance or discount loans. This augments their capacity for deposit creation, because the banks do not have to keep any amount aside as a required reserve and can lend the entire amount. This discretionary finance to banks should be added to the stock of reserve money.
The general model of money multiplier can be given as M3 is equal to 1 plus C plus T multiplied by C plus R bracket 1 plus T raised to the power of minus 1 multiplied by H star plus DF minus ER, where H star is equal to non-borrowed reserve money, DF is equal to discretionary finance provided, and ER is equal to desired excess reserves. Let us now recapitulate what we have learned in this module. High-powered money is sometimes called the monetary base. It includes all cash, even vault cash at commercial banks, and commercial bank deposits at central bank, which are redeemable in cash. It is money produced by the RBI and the government and held by the public in the form of currency C and by the banks in the form of reserves R. The supply of high-powered, therefore, can be represented as the government currency and reserve bank money. The structural composition of H reveals that the proportion of government currency in the hands of the public and banks. In addition to this, we have also discussed reserve bank credit to various sectors of the economy. From the policy point of view, all changes in H can be classified into two categories: autonomous or discretionary changes in H, and endogenous or non-discretionary changes in H. Adjusted H is affected by changes in CRR and SLR, and thereby affect the money supply in the economy.